So, how do I start off? I'm Alice. Alice Catherine Martineau. I'm a singer-songwriter. I live in Notting Hill, and last year I signed a record deal. In the next 60 minutes, you're going to learn everything about my life. My music, my friends, my family. But there is one thing that I haven't yet mentioned, and that is that I suffer from cystic fibrosis, a condition that affects the lungs and digestive system. And I am now currently waiting for a heart, lung, and liver transplant. So, where shall we start? I think it's probably best if we start my story at the beginning. It was a warm summer's night in Wimbledon on June the 8th, 1972, that I popped out into this world. The minute I was born, it was clear that there was something not quite right. My parents heard the doctor say, "There's something wrong with this baby." My skin had taken on a bluish tinge, and I was struggling to breathe. Mom and Dad were suddenly thrust into a terrifyingly unfamiliar world. They had never even heard of cystic fibrosis, CF, let alone knew what it was. They were told I had a life expectancy of just 10 years. But how wrong they were. I had a great childhood. This is my mum. She likes cats, Audrey Hepburn, and my dad. This is my dad. He likes skiing, Chris Christopherson, and my mum. This is my brother Luke. He likes painting. The two ladies in his life, Bella and Grace, and he loves playing Scrabble. And he's going to tell you all about me.
It would mean more to her than absolutely anything if Chris Martin of Coldplay were to ring up and say, "Alice, I heard the album, wicked. You know, I want to meet you for tea."
This is my cousin, Livy. She likes laughing, buying new clothes, and babies. This is my friend, Jan. He is my oldest friend. He likes the Isle of Mull, the Wizard of Oz, and Anna, his girlfriend. This is my friend, Shah. She likes having massages, pubs, and ham sandwiches. And they're going to talk all about me.
She basically last night said, "You must come across that I'm a really good swimmer." And I was like, "Alice."
You've never swum in your life.
She has, but.
Yeah, but not well.
Yeah, exactly.
She could swim on a lie, though, but not actually.
Yeah, she's very good at lie this week.
Great at swimming on a lie.
During my childhood, I did everything that any other child does.
I don't think there are any sort of real blots on our memories of childhood. I mean, one of the things that I always meant sort of say is that as a family, really, we're much closer because of Alice's illness.
I always knew I was slightly different because, you know, I had to take loads of tablets and I was on a low-fat diet. But I wouldn't have said I was ill. I've never had attitude of an old person.
She was definitely the naughty one.
You know, my mother smacked me on the bottom several times, often. I love my childhood. I had a very happy childhood. I think it's time that you understand exactly what CF is. This is Professor Geddes. He likes motorbikes, art, and Italy. He's going to tell you all the science stuff about CF.
Cystic fibrosis is an inherited disease where one single gene goes slightly wrong. You need two copies of the defective gene to get the disease. About one in 25 people have one copy of the defective gene. Two of those people have to meet, and then their children have the risk of getting both copies of the defective gene and having the illness. People who are born with the faulty gene get lung infections and get problems with digestion. All of us are breathing in dust and bacteria all the time and clearing it out again. With somebody with cystic fibrosis, their lungs are too dry and they don't have enough water in them to flush out any bacteria that land there, so they get infected. The digestive problems of cystic fibrosis are similar. The lung infections are the important part, and it's that that leads to episodes of illness, which get increasingly bad as the person gets older, destroys the lungs, and eventually, sadly, still kills almost everybody with cystic fibrosis during childhood or early adult life.
Can we move on?
Well, Alice rather fancies that she is the queen of the Scrabble board. And actually... nope. She's very good at Scrabble. She's very good. But I'm better.
That's so crap. One of my likes. I love rice pudding. Absolutely love rice pudding. I love water, lakes and rivers. And I love cats. And my thing about cats is cats have 9 lives. And I very strongly believe that I've had probably about 5 or 6. So far, and so I've got a good few to go. Oh, and I love E.T., absolutely love him. And I just feel something, when I feel warmth towards him. I feel an inner glow like he does as well. This may sound really weird, and it will sound weird, but I've always felt that E.T. and I are kind of like the same person. His heart stopped beating and then he was brought back to life again. I also have had near, you know, misses, as it were, and have got better and my heart started beating again. And also, we share very strange fingers. Primary school was great. I really loved primary school.
I was at school there. We were very good friends.
At my primary school, they were so good. I was never excluded from anything. But if I was ill or wasn't feeling well, they rallied round and helped me. So they were really lovely, lovely girls.
She used to hate sports days because she wasn't very good at it. And we used to always be last. So we used to hold hands over the line so that neither of us were actually last, we were equal last. Didn't really count. And I can't really remember whether she made me do that or I wanted to do that, but I was always near the back. She might have made me.
Secondary school wasn't so good.
I mean, it's strange to imagine, but I think she was bullied, you know, probably not in a sort of, in any physical way, but I think she had a miserable time there for some time, and I remember her coming home and crying, and so I just, you know, absolutely gutting, and they perceived her to be different, they perceived her to be weaker, and they perhaps preyed on it.
Enough, enough, go on to the next bit. Things I dislike are spiders, being called brave.
But yeah, you're not allowed to use the B word.
I absolutely hate being called brave because it's not true.
So brave.
I think you're brave. That's our worst. Stand it. Yeah, that's our worst.
And underground car parks. Music has always played a massive role in my life.
Now, we were sort of brought up, I mean, initially on my mum's music. It was her taste that then sort of, you know, kind of got us into music. And a lot of those bands and artists are still our favourites, or my favourite.
You two, the Beatles, were a massive inspiration to me. But someone I idolised was Madonna. I just was Madonna. I was her every day. When I was about 13, I went through, like, chains, cross earrings, crosses, the whole works. Most people sing into their hairbrush. I actually have got a nebulizer that I sang into. That was perfect, really. And it did the job. After Madonna, I was into the Smiths and the Cure for a bit. But I was then massively into Kylie, which wasn't probably that cool at that stage. But I loved her. So I used to get dressed up in all that gear and dance in front of the mirrors and go out clubbing, you know, with little hot pants on.
Say you won't need me no more. For me, her ability to tell, it's like white lies, was mostly with her mum and dad.
Yeah.
And she was absolutely world famous at it. Mm. Really, really good when she was sort of just starting to go out with boys.
Yeah, she used to go to, when she was sort of 14, she'd get into sort of dodgy nightclubs and just dance the night away like some wild child. And her mother would have no idea what she was doing, not a clue. And then the next day she'd just be, you know, she'd be in bed for about 3 days.
She was doing her thing on the podium, and this was in Spain, in a huge club, and basically she lost her footing, fell backwards into the DJ booth. She actually knocked out the entire club sound system. She was so embarrassed about it.
She pretended she was...
Yeah. She had to be carried out. She wasn't unconscious, but she pretended to be unconscious because she was so embarrassed.
About it.
I don't know if the club got their system back up.
Up until my teenage years, I'd say I lived in pretty much a normal life of any teenager. And then I had a brief stint working as a model, but it was quite brief. And I wasn't very good at it. I was in Jigsaw one day, and someone came up to me and said, have you ever thought of being a model? And I was, at the time I was 17, and thought, yeah, I could handle that, it'd be quite cool. I was a little bit small for them, but they put these seeds into my head, you see. So I went round to a couple of agencies and was taken on by Nev's agency.
When she was doing her modelling, I think it was quite hard for her because, you know, everyone was doing things, going away on their gap years. Everyone, all her friends from school were going off for 6 months abroad, and obviously she could never do that. So she's like, right, I'm gonna have done something in my gap year. I'm not gonna just sit around.
It was, I suppose you could say, a bit of a stupid profession for me to go into, because a model's life involves a lot of traipsing around from casting to casting, and even if you're fit and healthy, it's quite exhausting. So I used to struggle somewhat.
Hi, the casting's Emily.
And you'd get inside, and there'd be like a metal staircase, sort of 5 stories high, and you'd be like, oh my God, I've got to get up 4 of them. You also knew that the people who'd buzzed you in knew what time they buzzed you in, so you couldn't spend hours waiting on the stairs. You know, you'd have to think of a pretty good excuse of why it took you half an hour to get off there. And I didn't want to arrive, because that would not look good for a model. It was then that I learnt little tricks to hide having CF, I guess, to hide my exhaustion and my, you know, anything that wouldn't make me look vulnerable or in need of help or sympathy, because I couldn't bear that.
She's always wanted to seem as normal as possible.
Yeah.
And she will go to any length to keep her illness away from everyone. Yeah.
The walking back then was more of an issue than my breathlessness. I was a bit wobbly, and I've always walked slightly strangely because I had a vitamin E deficiency. So I used to go through a complete mental torture when I had to walk into that room, and there'd often be like a panel of people there on a desk. And you'd have to walk in, and they'd watch, they'd scrutinize you every step you took. I've always chosen professions that have been a huge challenge for me. I think it's a form of escapism for me, very much. It's something that completely is so away from hospitals and being ill.
Alice, could you hold this flower for us now, please?
And I think that's why it's always held so much attraction to me. Because they're all about looking good, feeling good, looking great. I went to Warwick University.
I went with her and her mum to take her there. And I think her mum was terrified. And Alice was just so determined, there was no way that she was not going to be normal. Even though I'm sure her doctors would have said, you know, be much better off. She wanted to prove that she could do it. She did. Mm.
My lecture rooms were a good 10 minutes walk from my halls of residence. And I basically just got completely exhausted walking there. Everyone used to leave together to get to the lectures. And I ended up leaving about half an hour earlier than everyone else so that I could A, have stops on the way, and B, recover when I got there. So I didn't look like a sweaty old dog, which was fine. I was there for about 3 weeks, and then I got ill. I had to come back to London because I got another infection. And I went back into hospital and ended up being very ill and was in and out of hospital for about 4 months. And that was my first wake-up call, like, I am actually ill. Because up until that point, I didn't have CF in my head. I had something similar, but it wasn't CF. I then started at King's College the following year and got a degree in English there. Getting my first university was one of the most amazing days of my life. I remember looking down on the list, scouring the list and looking at the 2-1s because I thought I'd probably got a 2-1. my name wasn't there, so I was a bit despondent. Looked down at the 2-2s. My name wasn't there, and I thought, God, don't tell me I've got a third. I looked down at thirds, my name wasn't there, and I thought, come on, I can't possibly have got a first. I really didn't work that hard. And then I looked up and there were like 5 people who'd got a first, and I was one of them, and I just could not believe it.
She got a first in her university. I mean, you just, Alice is a winner. She just is such a winner.
I was taken seriously for the first time for something other than being ill. And it gave me so much determination to go on and write. And so I started writing, which led to writing music and my music, really. At this stage, I need to introduce you to the following.
Right, my name's Phil Long and I manage Alice Martineau.
He's one of my managers.
My 3 favourite things are my wife, my cat and Alice Martineau.
This is Stevie Langer. She's one of my vocal trainers.
Body for you. Hi, I'm Stevie Langer, the big mouth.
So this is Howard.
My name is Howard Toshman. I am a songwriter, manager, a bit of a producer. I've managed Daphne and Celeste and worked with Alice Martineau.
Hello.
David Antoven likes flower beds, Robbie Williams and me. A friend of mine's stepdad is Robbie Williams' manager.
Alice came in and she came in with a tape, actually, and played it to me. I liked her a lot and I loved her enthusiasm.
The next year, I was having meetings with him.
I've helped her with enthusiasm.
He basically encouraged me to keep on writing.
I always gauge whether they actually really are trying to live their dream. That's how I always judge people, and she's definitely living her dream.
I've always wanted to be a singer, you know, it's that kind of thing when you're young. What do you want to be when you grow up? I want to be a pop star.
Well, she's an exhibitionist. You know, from the earliest years, you know, I almost sort of go up and catch her, you know, appearing in the mirror.
You know, when I first told people that I was singing or that I wanted to be a singer, and they were just like, choose something else, Alice. Come on. Alice, why don't you choose something a little bit easier?
Of all things to choose, and I don't mean just because she's ill, the road is scattered with the corpses of those that have not, you know, succeeded.
Come on, you'll get tired singing, you know, there. And I was like, well, no, I want to sing. And actually, having CF makes you more determined to succeed, definitely, especially if people are going, I don't think you can. It's like a challenge, and you want to get out there and prove them wrong.
I never thought she could sing.
No, I really didn't.
Alice is a very funny person. She's very amusing. I couldn't work with anyone who didn't make me laugh. She's tough as well. She knows what she wants. She really does, and if she doesn't like something, she'll tell you she doesn't like it. You know, she's very strong-willed.
So Howard's got his own little studio in Holloway. I pitched up at his studio with a demo that I'd recorded. He listened to it and he said, I like your voice. He then started co-writing songs. Together.
Obviously, Alice has problems breathing. Her lungs don't work like the rest of ours do. So I wasn't sure how it's going to sound, but it sounded. It was very interesting. I think maybe because of the way her lungs work, that's what gives her sound.
Alice's lung capacity is very, very badly damaged. I wish I knew how it was possible for somebody to sing with such badly damaged lungs.
I met Alice through Robbie Williams' manager, David Antoven. The first song she played was Inside of You, which completely blew me away. And then we went into the logistics of how difficult it was for her to breathe. So when most people breathe, they go, and the tummies go in. That should happen. First part is diaphragm, and then a second breath up into the lungs, so you get twice as much air. When I worked with Alice, it was really difficult for her to breathe slowly. So what we did is we incorporated in a quick breath, so you get the whole lot in one go. So that was one of the things we did with her. That muscle there is the muscle that controls everything. It's the chi. And this muscle hardens and tightens. And Alice, I found, had the strongest diaphragm muscles that I've ever come across in my life, because she coughs a lot because of her condition. It's really difficult as a singer, but she just overcomes it. She just, this voice just came sailing out, you know, it's amazing.
Right Time was the first song that we wrote together.
His publishers loved it. So that kind of spurred me on to do more.
She's really on it, you know, she really wants this to happen. More so than a lot of other artists, you know, who kind of held back for whatever reason. She would just go and get it.
Alice is just the hungriest person I've ever met in my life, because she knows that she has this amazing talent and she also has this dreadful curfew. Nothing stops her. She just goes for it. She'll have moments where she's absolutely brilliant and then she's really ill. And still, she gets past it and she just gets on with it. It's just full on Alice.
Yeah, I'm sure she'd love all the partying and the film premieres, but I don't think that's the main reason why she's in it. I think she wants to do something that people say, you know, we think that's great.
I'm frankly baffled as to how well people with cystic fibrosis can do when much of the rest of the human race can't do as well when they're healthy. If I try to catalogue all the things that have happened to Alice's body, and a beautiful body at that, since she's had cystic fibrosis, it's a terrible catalogue, in fact.
This is all the kind of stuff that I need to take, and I'm going to do it really quickly. Inhaler, high-calorie milkshake, syringe, different inhaler, nebulizer, insulin pen, colomycin vial, Atrovent vials.
The antibiotics.
Prion tablets.
Extra antibiotics.
Lysec.
Antibiotics have to be breathed in. Full tubes, extra tubes.
Vitamin E.
She needs to use a nebulizer.
Vitamin K,
it's not just a nebulizer.
Colomycin.
Nutritional supplements and enzymes.
Atrovent.
Physiotherapy.
Ventolin.
Then on top of that,
DNA.
Injection treatment.
Meropenem.
There'll be an antibiotic.
Atrovent.
Bronchodilators to try to open the
pipes.
An inhaled form of cortisone. Alice has to spend many hours a day just to stand still to avoid getting any worse. As the disease progresses, that burden becomes heavier and heavier and heavier and almost intolerable.
But it's just not a big deal. It's just part of what I do every day, and it's, please don't think it's a big deal, because it's just not, and people think, oh my God, how can you take all those things? But it's just part of my life. Like, you have to clean your teeth. I have to take my drugs.
It is absolutely amazing how well people like Alice cope with life in spite of that burden.
Word got around that I was looking for management.
I first came across Alice because 2.5 years ago, my lawyer passed me on a demo CD of 4 of Alice's songs, which I took home, played them over and over again, thought they were wonderful, got in touch with Alice, went to meet her, signed her to a short-term contract, and then went hell for leather trying to get the record industry interested. I had a friend at a particular music publishing company who he played the demos to, and they really got it. The senior guy there got Alice in, and she sang a couple of songs to him with a backing track.
You don't ever know how much you reveal to people is gonna freak them out.
Hi, just take the lift to the top floor.
But it's easier to just tell them nothing and pretend that you're completely healthy and make up excuses for why you can't do things that are completely normal. And I always prayed that there'd be a long wait for the lifts, because again, I could catch my breath before walking into the lift. Because in a lift, in a closed space, if your breath is, people can hear it. I thought, do I sit, do I stand? Is it going to be obvious if I sit down? And then I thought, oh, fantastic, I've hurt my leg. So I used that one, which I sometimes did used to use. I wrapped it up in a bandage and everything. I fell down the stairs, typical, I'm so clumsy, and so that I could hobble and therefore sit down to do it, but still perform. I'm walking in the room.
Hi, I'm Alice.
And also hobbling makes you more out of breath than actually just walking anyway, because you've got to do the whole sort of wobbly bit.
Nice to meet you.
Did you hurt your leg or something?
Yeah, I'm really sorry, I won't be able to dance today. I fell over and hurt my leg.
You want to just pop your CD in the machine over there? That'd be fantastic.
Then I'm really trying to recover my breath, and they're all staring at me, and I'm desperately trying not to show them that I'm out of breath. So I keep on sort of smiling and, you know, and you have to be on form as well as trying to not show them that I'm out of breath and trying to get my breath back so that I'm going to be okay when I sit. So I then fiddled around with that, trying to and pretended that, you know, it took me quite a while to get the track to where it was and whatever, which allowed me to get my breath back.
Really good. We'll contact your manager.
And then I was offered a deal about 3 weeks later.
He was very impressed. Then really took us out to lunch, winders and dinders. Wanted to do a deal with us, offered us a deal. And then it slowly went cold after that.
My managers told them that I was ill. Never heard from them again. Take what you want from that. I personally took it that they freaked out and they didn't want to invest money in me when I was ill.
And then, I think after that fell through, we sort of ran out of steam and Alice went her own way and I went mine.
I had a lot of near misses and thought I was going to get signed and then wasn't. And I didn't really think I'd ever be accepted as a singer with CF. I thought people would just see the CF and not the singer bit. That's what stopped me going forward, to be honest. I got to a stage where I was really getting quite exhausted and my health was deteriorating, and I just thought, not gonna happen.
She probably has more treatment now than ever before.
Well, eventually somebody with cystic fibrosis gets to a stage when treatment is just containing the condition, but not really treating it very well. And then I have to consider whether a transplant would be the right option. You know, when your doctor says to you, the time has come for a transplant, you have reached the end of the road. And that obviously is devastating. And even for somebody as robust and cheerful as Alice, it's devastating.
The end of the road? I don't think so. I'm just at the beginning. Of my road.
With Alice, we talked about it and decided about 18 months ago that we should begin to do the tests and get her on the list.
I certainly, when the transplant came about and it was being talked about and everything, it wasn't really a shock as such, but it did make you realise quite how serious it was and or is.
The success rate for lung transplant operations is getting better all the time. It's now well over 70%, but that still means failures in as many as 1 in 5. And in the case of Alice, when a liver transplant would be necessary as well, the experience is so small. Only very few people have had a 3-organ transplant in the world so far that it's very difficult to talk about success rates, but it inevitably will be less than that 80%. it could be a lifesaver and a door opening onto a fantastic new life, or it could be a journey to an operating theatre and not to come out again.
You know, but it's a real, it's a hope, you know, it's great.
I'm Andrew Armour. I'm a lecturer in physics at the University of Nottingham. The three things I like, let's see, nice cup of coffee, Saturday mornings, definitely, and playing badminton, that's good. I had a heart, lung and liver transplant about 5 years ago because I was born with cystic fibrosis. From the very moment that you take your first breath, you know that something is completely different about you because, you know, you're used to CF lungs and they feel completely different. I mean, whenever you breathe in, you can feel things all over the place in CF lungs. You know, there's stuff around and you can feel it and you're aware of it. And then after a transplant, it's all gone. I mean, it's all completely empty and it's amazing. And you know, anytime you breathe in, you just remember that.
I carry a pager around with me. And if it goes off, then I have 2 hours to get to the hospital to have a heart, lung and liver transplant. Being on the transplant list means I can't go on holiday. It means I can't go any further than 2 hours away from London. When the pager goes off, I will pack my... Well, I've actually got a bag packed already. I'll just get to the hospital as soon as I can and go and have my transplant.
Can't guarantee a transplant. It's a gift, it's a possibility, but it's, you know, I think it's important to live as though you think you will carry on living.
It's a fine line. You don't dwell on it. You don't think about it all the time. You don't, in fact, you try as much as you can not to think about the inevitability of death, who knows when, in the mid to short to long term, we don't know. You just say, these are the things I've got to do now. This is what's required of me now, this week. In Alice's case, these are the things that I have to do to keep alive and to keep well. In our case, these are the things I have to do in order to not make myself just crumple up and be completely, you know, and want to just give up because it's so awful and terrible what Alice has to suffer. You just say, no, I've got a job to do, I've got a life to lead, Alice has hers, and we just get on with it.
I've been waiting for 2 years for my transplant. The reason it's been such a long time is because there are just not enough organs available for transplantation. Not enough people carry donor cards.
There's nothing you can do about waiting for a transplant. You know, nothing you can do about that. You don't really even want to hope for it too much. But once you wake up, it's back in your hands to some extent.
I think people don't want to think about, obviously, about death. So people don't become organ donors.
The offer of organs transforms somebody else's life. And I think it's always worth thinking about that. I mean, those who receive these gifts are very aware of the circumstances under which they're made. And it's not something you ever forget.
She has looked into the abyss, you know, she's come out fighting, smiling, and getting on with it. Now that's okay, it's maybe a bit trite to call it bravery, but I think that's what it is at the end of the day. And maybe it's the kind of bravery that we're all gonna have to one day come to terms with or get a bit of. But Alice has had to do it from a very early age, and that's the difference. I think you have to train yourself to live for each moment. And Alice makes a philosophy of that. Yeah, it's in her songs.
June the 15th, 2002. I get the Telegraph delivered. Julie arrived on the doorstep on the Saturday morning, and there's Alice on the front cover. It was an article she'd written all about herself. It was sort of a cathartic thing for Alice. She was coming out saying, listen, I've got cystic fibrosis.
She said, I'm doing some article for the Telegraph. Mm-hmm. And I just imagined this sort of little page thing. And I was just stunned when I read it, because I really didn't think it was going to be that big a thing. I was quite surprised that she'd gone into that much detail, considering her lengths to avoid everything.
She mentioned the music towards the end of the article. She wasn't going to mention music at all. I phoned her up immediately that morning and said, shall we go forward with this? Shall I have another go? She said yes. Off we went again.
This is Nick and Joe from Sony.
I'm Joe Tarrington and I do A&R for Sony.
My name's Nick Raphael. I'm Vice President of Sony Music.
And they're going to tell you what they like.
Bed, music, sister.
Oh, my son, Charlie, his mother, Amanda, and music.
How it happened was somebody dropped a CD off on my desk, which happens all the time. Her voice was very haunting. The songs were great. Loved it immediately. Took it straight to Nick.
After being quite cynical to Joe and saying, well, let's meet her and I'll sort of make my mind up when I met her.
24 hours later, we met Alice.
Never did I feel more strongly about signing an artist post that meeting. Because of the artist, because of what she said, because of how she behaved in that meeting. And a lot of artists have this element of self-doubt, and Alice didn't seem to have that. She seemed to have this complete self-belief. For me, Alice having CF, initially I thought about it and thought, ish, this is a bigger decision than usual. And Alice had a lot of great ticks in her tick boxes, and then she had a box that I'd never even had to consider before, which was personal health. So I'm guilty if I don't sign her because she's ill, and I'm guilty if we sign her because I'm exploiting she's being ill, on the other hand. And it's like, you can't win. So my attitude is you make the decision solely on the basis of it's good or it's bad. And the fact of the matter, in my opinion, is it's better than good. It's f***ing brilliant.
And when you meet Alice, after you know, 2 minutes, she's not ill. You don't think of her as ill. She's just Alice.
From June the 15th to signing the record deal was signing the record deal on August the 1st. So it was an amazingly quick process.
I remember I was shaking. I just could not believe it. Could not believe it.
Normally, when it's something you love, that's how it happens. You just listen to it and you kind of know. Before we had done the deal, we were already talking to producers, going through all the tracks.
The focus on getting this done was completely unique.
This is Bacon and Cornby.
My name is Jonathan Cornby. Clip and Bacon, and we are record producers.
And they're going to tell you what they like.
When I used to do paragliding, taking off into the wind, very exhilarating. Good wine and The Temptations.
They produced Breathe Tonight on my album.
She came in and made it so clear right from the word go there was nothing, there was no issue about anything. You could see she was really psyching herself up for the Breathe Tonight, and she just went and did it. It was absolutely amazing. Even the singing teacher was like, whoa, wow, that's incredible.
Breathe Tonight was the track that I went down to the studio. And that was really hard for Alice because, she was really having trouble with her breathing at the time. And we were doing bit by bit, putting her through it, you know, and she was really difficult for her, but she just gets up there and does it, man, you know, you've got to admire it.
We were in awe. We were just sat here going... The thing was, she was able to find a way into the track and find a way. Into her voice and come up with a convincing vocal, which is an incredible achievement for somebody who technically probably shouldn't be able to do it.
I write all my music so that I've got gaps in between the words so that I can take a breath. I couldn't just sing any song on the radio.
She does her job really well, and her job is singing and songwriting.
I'm Joe Wiley, I'm a presenter at Radio 1, so I play records. My three favourite things, I've got three kids, so could that be it? Jude, Cass and India, they're my three favourite things in the world. I heard about Alice's music before I heard the actual stuff, and it was really impactful. I remember just sitting there being fairly blown away, really, by the power of it. It was really, you know, she's got a brilliant voice and really powerful music.
Well, she presented Sony with a very polished album.
Essentially, it's 11 really good pop songs, isn't it?
Great pop songs.
That are cool as well, and you're not embarrassed to like it. Alice desperately wanted to do a live gig, and I thought it was a great idea.
And I said, look, forget backing tracks or anything, let's get a full band in. And she's got a lot of friends who love her and really admire her music. Because at the end of the day, Alice is an incredible musician. We went through days of sorting it out. And she was worried because she said, well, can I stand up through the whole thing? And I said, don't worry about it. Just we'll sit you in a high chair and your music's going to come through.
What I do every day that I know I've got something planned, I wake up and I take an extra steroid, which I'm not really meant to do. So to all those CF sufferers out there, don't do what I do because it's not good. Every time I do something, I feel I'm taking a risk. Everything you do in life is a risk, really, if you look at it. There's nothing I like more than being on stage. It's just the most incredible feeling of power, and you're up there, you're singing, you're singing your own songs that you've written as well.
The gig at the 606 Club was really special to her because it was sort of focused all her efforts of doing a live show in front of an audience.
And my mum came, and she'd never, ever... I've done gigs, quite a few gigs, and she's never come to one. And I really wanted her to come, because somehow there's something in me that was saying that that was my last gig I'd do before my transplant. I don't know why. And all my really good friends were there, and it was really emotional.
A few days before, she'd actually met Robbie Williams, who I work with, and he was knocked out with her and liked her music and said, you know, of course, can I come down to the gig?
And I never actually expected him to come, but he did. Someone said to me once, Alice, you can't get scared going on stage because you have confronted a fear that none of us confront, and that is, you know, facing your own mortality. Going on stage is nothing compared to that. Just think, every time you go on stage, hey, you know, I could be on the operating table now. And I'm not. This is child's play in comparison. And that's what I think.
We've been here with a very special artist who I've had the pleasure of working with for the last couple of years. Alice Martineau.
He gave her a standing ovation at the end of it, I mean, so did everybody. It was amazing.
And it was very special. It was a very special night.
Wow, what a great singer. Great music. I think Rob said to her afterwards that he was hoping that he could do some writing with her.
Robbie did say he would ring me.
Yeah, I'll get your number off.
Yeah, that song inside, love it.
I'm still waiting.
I have a lot of well-known people that I work with, and Duncan came down from Blue, and I said to him, Dunkey, you've got to hear this singer, what do you think? And I put it on, and he went, who the hell is that? I want it to be forever young. Then I told him the situation. I said, look, I really want you to meet Alice, because she'd love to write with you, and she wants to work, you know, she's a great fan of yours. And they went, yeah, yeah, we want to meet her. So I arranged for them to meet down at my studio and just see if I could get this thing together. And they all just fell in love with each other. Trying to find a way, a place safe in case I fall. From yesterday, you're letting me live. Oh, baby, no matter what you do. No, I'm watching over you. Do you feel it? Do you feel it too? Yeah. I went to meet the boys from Blue at Wembley with Steve. He's my other manager.
Hello, darling. Mm-hmm. We need to get together and write some songs.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Just chill out.
Yeah.
Get some inspiration. Do you know where you're going to be sitting? Stage left or right? Okay, we'll give you a big shout out.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, wicked.
Oh, come here. I love you.
And then Duncan got up on stage during the concert and said,
You've got a very special person in the audience tonight, guys. A friend of ours, Alice, who's got an album out. Go and buy it. Basically gave me a massive plug. Having 12,000 people at Wembley shout out your name, pretty cool.
It's important to get recognition from other artists. You want your peers' recognition. I think every artist does that, wants to be told by another artist, yes, you're doing really well, or yes, that is really good, or that song is fantastic.
Very, very, very few people make it to the stage that she has got to. And it's, I mean, it's brave of her, no, crazy of her to even think about doing it. But look, she's done it, you know.
Don't use that word. I hate that word.
Yes, I know. I deliberately used it to annoy her.
She hates the word she's brave, so I'm going to say you're so brave, Alice.
She's really, really brave.
Oh, God. People treat me as if I'm really brave, and I'm not brave. I'm just dealing with something that I have no option, and it makes me so angry when people come up and go, oh, Alice, hello, how are you feeling today? And it's just like, hello, I'm a normal person. You know, I just have problems with my lungs and, you know, my health. But I'm exactly the same as you are, exactly the same.
The one track that I really, really love is Inside of You. Just the lyrics are, they're quite special, really, and the music's just beautiful. Her voice is gorgeous on it.
My favourite song is Inside of You. I actually wrote the lyrics. I like to watch you from above. It's not an ordinary love. And those lyrics form the basis of the song. I have no musical training at all, really, so I don't really know what I'm doing. I just do it by ear. That chord, but that chord, they work together. I like to watch you from above, not ordinary love. The song is, it's about sort of, you know, when you're dead and you always think that you can, it's kind of almost like reincarnation, and you're living your life through someone you love, I guess, again.
Soul. It's the most, I think her lyric content is something to reckon with. Very, very, very special artist. That's what I want to say. Her music is to die for.
I'd love to think she was going to be successful. I would love to think she was going to be successful, but I'm not the general public, and it's always down to the general public and radio.
I think the final thing to say is just how Alice is a superb symbol of how people can fight against cystic fibrosis. And one of her big contributions to herself and everybody else is just how hard she fights and how much she achieves.
OK, well, I hope you've enjoyed rifling through my dirty clothes. Now, goodbye, really. I'll play it safe in case I fall from yesterday. You're letting me live inside of you. You're letting me live as someone new. I wanted to be forever. To love.